Here's what's coming up on today's show.
It gets dangerous when the taste of having more money, more power, more prestige increases ambition faster than satisfaction. In that case, one step forward pushes the goalpost two steps ahead. You feel as if you're falling behind, and the only way to catch up is to take greater and greater amounts of risk.
This is the Money Master Podcast from Brindle & Bay Wealth Management with Tori Tenhagen, Connie Davis, and certified financial planner Nick Davis.
Welcome back to the Money Master Podcast. This is a special book club episode. We're going to do The Psychology of Money by Morgan Housel. And today we're going to do chapters 3 and 4. The very first chapter starts with Never Enough. All right, so we're all sitting here. It's Connie, Tori, and Nick, and we've got our books open.
Yeah, Psychology of Money. Pages turning.
Yeah.
Yeah, this is a more relaxed type of podcast for us to do. We're enjoying reading this book. You know, if you haven't had yourself, you know, get a copy of it. It's a very easy to read, great mindsets. And so today we've got two new mindsets to talk about with The Psychology of Money. And this one is called Never Enough When Rich People Do Crazy Things.
And I was like, before we get into this chapter, I just want to thank everyone who's been listening and chiming in and putting out reviews and sending us messages saying how much they're really enjoying this podcast. And we've had several people call and say, hey, I went out and got the book, or I started listening to the audio version. So it's really exciting hearing your guys' feedback on the book as well. So thank you for that.
Well, and you typically think like a finance book. Ugh, yeah. I don't know. But that's what it is. It's really interesting. Like it's a really interesting book.
Full of very good stories. And I have to say that my favorite story, and Tori, I see you have it highlighted too. I've said this story so many times in my different videos on YouTube and whatnot.
Well, and even in meetings, I've heard you say it, this story.
So tell me the story then.
Go ahead. I have it open. I can read it.
It's about John Bogle. It's about John Bogle, the founder of Vanguard, who passed away a few years ago, 2019. So what's the story, this iconic story?
So he was at a party and people around him were talking. And, well, it'd be better if I read it because people may not know the story.
Go ahead.
At a party by a billionaire on Shelter Island, Kurt Vonnegut, is that how you say that?
I guess so.
Informs his pal Joseph Heller that their host, a hedge fund manager, had made more money in a single day than Heller had earned from his wildly popular novel Catch-22 over its whole history. Heller responds, yes, but I have something he will never have. Enough. It says, enough. I was stunned by the simple eloquence of a word. Stunned for two reasons. First, because I've been given so much in my own life. And second, because Joseph Heller couldn't have been more accurate. For a critical element of our society, including many of the wealthiest and most powerful among us, there seems to be no limit today on what enough entails.
That's such a powerful story. I remember
enough.
Nick, you telling that story to me before I had even picked up this book. And then when I got to this chapter and I read it, I was like, man, it just hit me again. Like, I have something that he will never have enough. Yeah. Like,
and that being okay. Because I think a lot of people aren't okay with saying, I'm fine where I am.
Yes.
Yeah.
And I don't need you to tell me that's enough. I know it's enough. It's a mindset.
Being comfortable with what you have. Being happy with what you have.
There are some retirees that I admire that we have all commented on, and it's that they have decided what their level of lifestyle is going to be, and they are happy with it. And I've always, you can tell those people enjoy life better than the people who have not figured that out yet.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
This is huge. Knowing, and the people I'm thinking of actually chose a lifestyle that's actually slightly lower than my lifestyle, and they're happy as can be, you know, and I think that that's something to envy. I think it's something to actually try to model. There's stories in this chapter about hedge fund managers and billionaires that aren't happy because they're just trying to keep up mm-hmm. with the next hedge. You know, if you're a billionaire, you're upset because you're not the biggest billionaire.
Right.
Or if you're there, you know, if you're making, you know, $33 million a year, you're not happy because you're not making
$34 million,
or $700 million. Yeah. You know, are some of the wild stories in this particular chapter. But I just love how humble he was.
Well, and I like this story too because Nick, I know sometimes you ask people this question, or we've talked about this before. But you know, if you were going to live a minimalistic life, like what would you need to have to make you happy.
Yeah, to be happy.
And when you really think about it, it really comes down to just a very few things.
Yeah.
You know, for me to be completely happy would be my family nearby, a home with a sunset view, with a great view, and some books and great food.
Yeah. So the I can't remember the guy's name now. It's going to drive me nuts because he's so popular, but he's the founder of an old company in the 90s called CD Baby. And he answered that question. And, you know, he basically sold his company for billions of dollars, and he immediately started to go and build another billion-dollar company. And he said, wait a minute, why am I doing this? And so he said, what do I need to be happy? And I'm going to have to look up his name in a second, but Tori's going to look it up, CD Baby. Anyway, he said, I just need a small house, like not a big house, like pretty small. I need a laptop, I need books, and I need friends. And he responds to people's emails, and he started a blog.
Derek Sivers?
Derek Sivers, there it is. And so Derek Sivers, one of his contributions is he's got a page on his website where it's like / book reviews. And so he'll read books, and then he will literally make his own personal bullet point notes for the entire book. And I will just go and read those bullet points from the books because it's, and you know, he'll rate the book in terms of how much he liked it. And anyway, he figured out what is enough. Now there's another really popular story in this chapter. Anybody care to say what it is?
It's Madoff.
Madoff.
Oh gosh.
We all watched that documentary too, and we're talking about it for weeks after.
It's so interesting.
The biggest takeaway from that is you had a legitimate success.
Successful.
And it wasn't enough. That's exactly why he kept going, right? It wasn't enough.
Yeah, this chapter says that his legitimate business was so successful, it constituted like 7% of the market movement every day. And it made, you know, multi-millions of dollars, and yet that wasn't enough for him. So that's when he went into his illegitimate side of things. Crazy. So there's three or four bullet points in this chapter, okay? And the first one I think is worth saying, and that is the hardest financial skill is getting the goalpost to stop moving, right? So I'll just read here. It says, it gets dangerous when the taste of having more money, more power, more prestige increases ambition faster than satisfaction. In that case, one step forward pushes the goalpost two steps ahead. You feel as if you're falling behind, and the only way to catch up is to take greater and greater amounts of risk. The last sentence is worth saying, happiness is just results minus expectations.
That's so good. I had all of that underlined as well.
Yeah, I had the last sentence highlighted.
Yeah.
So what does that last sentence mean to you?
You know, we put these great expectations out there, like how things should go, how they should be, or how things should turn out. And when we have such high expectations, the higher the risk of getting let down, right? Mm-hmm. So, you know, happiness is just results minus expectations. It's
you're happy with the results you have.
Seeing,
I think about this in terms of what we talk to our members about this of, are you only going to be happy? Are you really seeking returns in a 1-year time period? Is that what's going to make you happy? Or is a good retirement going to make you happy?
Yeah.
That's what we're looking at. It's the expectation of, well, I needed to get this return this year. But did you really?
Right.
Was that really what you needed?
Right.
Because, or could you be happy without that return this year? Because you're actually looking for something different.
Yeah. Well, what this means to me is happiness is results minus expectations. I was thinking about stoicism this morning when I was doing my jog this morning. I tried to run and then I started walking. And stoicism, they practice reverse negative visualization, and it increases your gratitude. So instead of like being upset about what you don't have, I was just like listing out, hey, I my children are healthy. I don't have any illnesses. Boy, I could have them and that would not be cool, right? That would suck. Mm-hmm. We don't have any clients that are mad at us. You know, we don't have, you know, you name the negative things. Like I got a good night's sleep. I didn't get a horrible night's sleep. You know, there's all these things that you can always, you know, use to increase your gratitude. Happiness is, what do I have? And I don't have too many expectations around it, right? Or at least, you know, balancing what your expectations are in the results that you have. So that's the first of the three or four points. The other one is social comparison is the problem here.
Well, and I thought about that as soon as we talked about the whole enough idea.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
You mm-hmm. only have enough if you're not comparing yourself to other people, right? I mean, I think about the clients that come and sit here and have chosen their lifestyle that's going to make them happy in retirement. And yeah. and a lot of them are living somewhat below their means, but they're yeah. happy because yeah. they're not comparing. Yeah. We also have people come in here who are living below their means and they're miserable.
Yeah.
Because they want to be living differently. They haven't chosen that's, right. that that's enough.
That's right.
And so it's the comparison of, oh, I want to be doing this that really gets you.
Social comparison is the problem here, is the second point. And I heard somebody say that people were happier in the 50s and 60s because there was a less of a divergence between the middle class and the wealthy. And what happens is that when you see people your age and you see what they have, you think that you should have those things too. And so in the 50s and 60s, when people looked around, people could afford, one new car and one used car. It was socially normal to go camping for vacation. And it was normal for one person to work and support the entire household. So because the social norms were like that, there wasn't this unhappiness. But once there was the divergence between the wealthy and the middle class, unhappiness increases.
Technology to see everybody's life.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You didn't have access to everybody's information of what they were doing on their Europe vacation. Yeah. You knew your neighbors and your close family. You know, you weren't yeah. seeing so many people doing right. different than you.
Here's a quick break to tell you about a video I recently finished. The video is called 3 Ways to Reduce Taxes on Your Social Security Benefits. Up to 85% of your Social Security can be taxed federally. And it's really a form of double taxation because you paid tax on it every year that you contributed. So in this short video, I'm going to share 3 ways to reduce or eliminate taxes on your Social Security benefits. There's no cost to get that video. All you have to do is text us the letters SS to our office line, which is 214-988-9178, and we'll get that right to you. Again, it's text the letters SS, like Social Security, to 214-988-9178. So that's the second one. The third point is enough is not too little. So that's a takeaway. Enough is not too little. What does that mean?
Well, the quote that I have, enough is realizing that the opposite, an insatiable appetite for more, will push you to the point of regret. I mean, it's like, mm-hmm. it's like eating too much. That's exactly what it is. Like, you regret it after.
You feel miserable.
Enough is not too little, meaning I have enough. It's not too little.
I've had my meal.
I've told myself that it's not enough for some reason.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I've had my meal. I'm happy. I don't feel sick to my stomach and I'm okay.
Yeah.
You know, like, and I'm good. And accepting that, that's really it. It's the acceptance of that.
I think there's a lot of acceptance that goes in retirement planning because, you know, for the most part, they say, hey, replace, say, 70, 80% of your income. Now, I can tell you that most of our clients do not want to live on 70% of what they were living on. Like, they want to live on 100% minus what they were saving for their 401k, minus any debts that they're getting rid of. And there is a level of accepting what you may have to accept so that you can have something greater, which is security, long-term security. All right, number 4, the last point for our takeaway from Never Enough chapter is there are many things never worth risking, no matter the potential gain. So I guess we would bring that back to the Madoff thing. He risked everything for some gain that was...
Well, and you literally bring it back to my enough is not worth risking. If Connie's enough is that house and her kids and her sunset view, then it's not worth risking that to do something, to chase a return or to compromise that actual enoughness.
Right, right.
Yeah. I think everything in this chapter kind of comes down to being content, you know, finding where your content level is, right? And staying in your own lane, like putting on those blinders and not constantly comparing yourself to your neighbor or to your Facebook mm-hmm. friends or whatever else is out
that
there.
That takes a self-awareness to right. say, yes. I may want that thing, but I have to acknowledge that may not be what's actually going to make me happy.
Right.
That takes a very aware person.
So I'm going to close out this chapter with the last paragraph of this chapter, and then we'll go to the next chapter because I think it flows nicely. And a lot of this chapter is talking about people who ruin their reputation because of taking these risks because they didn't have enough. So it says that this seems like the worst possible takeaway from his experience, and what I imagine is the comforting self-justification of a man who desperately wants his reputation back but knows it's gone, meaning a person who screwed up. But listen to the next part. Reputation is invaluable. Freedom and independence are invaluable. Family and friends are invaluable. being loved by those who want to love you is invaluable. And happiness is invaluable. And your best shot at keeping these things is knowing when it's time to stop taking risks that might harm them, knowing when you have enough. The good news is that the most powerful tool for building enough is remarkably simple. It doesn't require taking risks that could damage any of these things. And then he says, that's the next chapter. And what is that thing that can get you what you want, get you enough without risking your reputation? Chapter four is called confounding compounding. So compounding is the safe way, the smart way, the more sure way.
The long-term boring way.
Yeah. So instead of taking these big risks, how about we look into another psychological principle in the Psychology of Money, chapter four, confounding, compounding. And the quote on the first page here says $81.5 billion of Warren Buffett's $84.5 billion net worth came after his 65th birthday. Our minds are not built to handle such absurdities in terms of how compound interest works. We've all heard about it.
Mm-hmm. Right.
So Isaac Newton talked about it. So big lessons here. What are your thoughts about this chapter? Confounding, compounding. Connie said she wasn't super excited about it because it was kind of like something we all know that things just grow over time.
This is the chapter you want to hand everybody who is seeking fast returns. You're like, here, just read this. You know?
Yeah.
Like, it's like a,
yeah.
That's what you want this year? Okay, read this chapter.
So it talks at the beginning about, you know, he talks about the ice age and how moderately cool summers and not cold winters cause an ice problem that creates these huge amounts of ice and snow over time. And he kind of relates that to something very, very small compounding to something very, very big. And we all know stories of something very, very small turning into something very, very big. And
it just chips away over time.
Right. Yeah. It's amazing. So the one of the things that it says on page 49 is more than 2,000 books are dedicated to how Warren Buffett built his fortune. But many of them are wonderful, but few pay enough attention to the simple fact that Warren Buffett's fortune isn't due to just being a good investor, but being a good investor since he was literally a child.
Yeah, and then a few pages later it says, none of the 2,000 books picking apart Buffett's success are titled, this guy has been investing consistently for 3/4 of a century.
Yeah, no kidding, right?
Yeah.
Because everything is about now.
My biggest takeaway about that story is that, yeah, we all see his success and we forget the amount of time.
Because you see success and naturally, I mean, I think it's just a natural part of our brains. We want to recreate it now.
Right.
Yeah.
I see that that's possible. I want to do it fast.
Well, and it's about the astronomical amount of wealth that he got after he was 65 years old, right? I mean, the book talks about other people who were better investors. Actually, there was one guy who got a better return than Warren Buffett. And his net worth is crazy small because he'd only been doing it for 20 or 30 years compared to Warren Buffett's entire lifetime. Right. So again, $81.5 billion of his $84.5 billion came after his 50th birthday. I mean, it's huge how it really takes off later in life. And, you know, this is true across so many things.
Well, in comparison, it said, had he started investing in his 30s and retired in his 60s, few people would have ever heard of him.
Yeah, it wouldn't be astronomical.
Because his net worth, even though he averaged a 19% return, that's above average. It's just that he wasn't so astronomically different. And so going about what you were saying about, Tori, about books, there are books on economic cycles, trading strategies, and sector bets. But the most powerful and important book should be called Shut Up and Wait. It's just one page with a long-term chart of economic growth.
A one-page book.
There you go. That's it. Well, it's funny, even in terms of the last page, I'll read the quote on the last page. It says, good investing isn't necessarily about earning the highest returns because the highest returns tend to be one-off hits that can't be repeated. It's about earning pretty good returns that you can stick with, which can be repeated for the longest periods of time. That's when compounding runs wild. And then going back to the book should be Shut Up and Wait. Like when we read this quote, but when we were prepping for this episode, like you said, it's kind of like a diet, right? Like you just have to have a diet you can stick with. And Austin and I have been talking about this, about even again, social media. It's the fad of just fix your metabolism and you'll lose all the weight, or just do that. It's everybody wants the quick thing. Right. That's what our culture presses right now.
Right.
And that doesn't work in finance either. It's just not.
Right. It's what it's, you're paying attention to that 1 year return, that 2 year return, and you're missing the fact that there's a war you're fighting. And that war is the ability to get consistent returns over time for that compounding. And so I think that's probably one of the most basic things in a finance podcast or a finance book that we all should know about. Anything else stand out to you all about this chapter before we wrap it up and get ready for our next episode, about our next chapters?
I don't think so. For me, it's just stick with the norm. Do what other people are doing, right? Don't always chase the get rich quick scheme or the that sounds too good to be true. Well, it probably is, right? Just stick with the norm.
Long obedience in the same direction. That's the just stay the course.
Very good.
Well, thank you everyone for tuning in and listening or watching with us today. We appreciate you. Feel free to leave your feedback, leave us a review, and share with others.
Are you ready to take the next step in creating your own next chapter? Are you looking for calmness and clarity around your retirement future? We'd love to visit with you about that. It all starts with a 15-minute phone call, and you can get that set up on your phone or computer right now by going to brindleandbay.com, which is our website, and you would click on the button that says Let's Talk. Again, go to brindleandbay.com, click on the Let's Talk button, and let's get the conversation started.
Nick Davis is an investment advisor representative of Brindle and Bay Financial Advisors, a registered investment advisor. The show is for informational purposes only. Any exposure to ideas and financial vehicles discussed should not be considered financial advice or a recommendation to buy or sell a financial vehicle. You should consult a qualified financial, tax, or legal professional before taking any action. This program is not endorsed by the Social Security Administration or any other government agency. Annuity guarantees rely solely on the financial strength and claims paying ability of the issuing company. Insurance licensed in Texas, number 1188639. Brindle and Bay Wealth Management is affiliated with Brindle and Bay Financial Advisors.